The light flurries of snow tumble gracefully from the intrusive white sky. They seem to tango to their demise, circling maddeningly around each other until they make their final descent onto the heavily held shoulders of exposed villagers. Maybe if the times were different, the snow would be welcomed with an unabashed smile or a burst of glee in someone's rather dull day. However, the slowly melting flakes go ignored on the shoulders of the village people who stand in a semicircle, crowding around a woman who seethes her final remarks. The woman kneels on the ground with dignity, even though the snow seeps through the thin material of her skirt and leaves her numb from the thighs down. She takes a moment to appraise her final surroundings. The hooded figure that will behead her stands dutifully without regard to the holder of the soul he was about to steal. "You all make me sick." Her voice quivers from the cold. The approach was less melancholy than she had been hoping for, but then again, sorrow never did suit her well. She searches around for a knowing face amongst the crowd, the giveaway glimmer in their eyes that sparkled with intellect and rebellion. All she could spot, though, were endless faces that were illuminated with childlike curiosity. "My life is being stolen by a man who has never met me. A man who only knows me as a serial number and functioning piece to his assembly line. Best watch your tongue around those that represent that man," the hooded figure responded with a bored tone. The woman looks up at her killer and spits at his feet. Her eyes glare up at him with mischief. "Or what? You'll take my head?" She scoffs darkly and moves her attention back to the crowd. "You'll leave my frozen corpse when this is all over, and you'll sleep in your bed without any regard to me or what I feel and what it took to get me here. I've worked like you do, slaving over nothing without any cause, except in the name of a man whom I've never actually met. I would go to bed at night with my skin peeling off, trying to rid me of the chemicals I've been exposed to because of that terrorist." At first, the woman feels desperate to drive meaning into the crowd, but she knows the endeavor is useless. She lets the anxiety dissolve from her soul, because all feelings lack meaning now. She sits taller, places her scarred and calloused hands into her lap, and looks a child right in the eye, knowing his young mind will grasp her emotions stronger than anyone else. "I have lost all my memories of what the sun feels like tickling my exposed skin. I can't recall the smell of a spring day. All the memories I own are days spent painfully hunched over steaming vats that left my lungs begging for fresh air. I can recall the windowless factory and the voluntary searing of my own flesh. We accept the fact that he murders us, first mentally, then emotionally, and last, physically. We kill ourselves to deliver a product to that man, and he receives praise for our scorched skin, our black lungs, and glazed eyes. My stomach churns at the thought of calling him a saint one more time." The hooded figure grunts and pushes the woman's head down so it is almost touching the frozen stone ground. "Well, it's been fun, but I've had enough of your spreading heresy amongst this innocent crowd. Any last words?" "Death is better than life," she whispers. Silence follows the raising of the axe. The crowd watches as her head is detached. Her limbs twitch and then slump into a heap. They all stare emptily at the hooded figure, trying to grasp for meaning of what just happened. "Remember, he is always watching. We are the sinners and he is the saint. In Saint Nicholas, we seek all comfort and joy." The elves repeat the prayer and move back to their designated workstations to proceed with the toy making. Just as the invalid had predicted, not a single thought trailed to the image of her dead body, spilling hot blood that quickly cooled from the falling snow's frozen touch. They know that he is always watching.